Let's go ahead and talk about the anatomy of the dural venous sinuses. And we're going to do that by first going through the location of the dural sinuses, basically where they are in comparison to the meninges. And then we're going to visualize the dural venous sinuses schematically so that it's easier to remember the dural sinuses. And then in the next video, we're going to go through the cerebral veins and the emissary veins and the diploic veins and then the cerebral circulation in general. Alright, so the veins of the systemic circulation consist of four kind of systems. You have the veins of the heart, then you have the veins of the inferior vena cava, and the veins of the superior vena cava, and then you have the portal system. So the superior venous sinuses we're going to go through drain into the superior vena cava. So we can start by zooming in on this figure and then take a small section of the skull in order to see all the layers. So these are all the layers from the skin down to the brain tissue. So first we have the skin, all the dermal layers. Then underneath that we have the skull, and then the meninges, and then there's the cerebral tissue. So the meninges are what we're essentially going to focus on right now. So the meninges consist of three layers. You have the pia mater, which is the thinnest, most delicate layer that lies just on top of the surface of the brain tissue. Then superficially to that, you will find the arachnoid mater, which is slightly thicker than the pia mater. And underneath the arachnoid mater, you will find the subarachnoid space, which contains cerebrospinal fluid. And you will notice that there are these arachnoid granulations that take the cerebrospinal fluid and then just pumps them into the venous sinuses so that they can get back into the circulation to complete the circulation of the cerebrospinal fluid. Then superficial to the arachnoid mater, you will find the thickest meninges called the dura mater. And notice that the dura mater inside the cranium consists of two layers. There's first the periosteal layer, which lies very close to the skull. And then there's the meningeal layer, which lies very close to the arachnoid mater. And when you look at the spinal cord, you'll notice that dura mater only consists of one layer, which is the meningeal layer, because the periosteal layer stops at the foramen magnum. Notice that the periosteal layer and the meningeal layer are bound together and only separate when they form the dural venous sinuses and the dural septae. So if I would ask you, between which layers are the dural venous sinuses located inside the head? They are located between the periosteal and the meningeal layer of the dura mater. Awesome. Now finally, let's go ahead and go through the dural venous sinuses. So what we're going to do is that we're going to go through all the dural venous sinuses one by one, and we will use this table to help us do that. Alright, so first thing is that I've divided the dural venous sinuses into the ones that are located in the midline, the ones that are located laterally, the ones that are located posteriorly and anteriorly. And you will notice that when you're studying the dural venous sinuses, that there are different ways to categorize the different dural venous sinuses. You can also categorize them as paired and unpaired, for example. But I like this one, we'll stick with that. Alright, so first we have the superior and the inferior sagittal sinus. Then there's the straight sinus, which connects these two, or also called the sinus rectus. Laterally, you will find the transverse sinus, which continues as the sigmoid sinus, and then as the internal jugular vein. Then we have the superior petrosal sinus and the inferior petrosal sinus, which drain from the cavernous sinus. And then we have the sphenoparietal sinuses, which go along the sphenoid bone. Then we have the anterior and the posterior intercavernous sinuses, which connect the two cavernous sinuses. And then we have the basilar plexus. And, you know, plexus just means a network of structures. And the basilar plexus are just a plexus of veins that connect different adjacent structures together at the basal region of the skull. So it connects with the cavernous sinuses, it connects with the superior and the inferior petrosal sinuses, and it also goes down and connects with the vertebral veins. Then we have the occipital sinus, which is the smallest sinus. And then when the occipital sinus, the superior sagittal sinus, and the straight sinus meet, they form the confluence of sinuses. So those are the main dural venous sinuses that I want you to know. So let's go ahead and go through them in detail. First, we have the superior sagittal sinus, which, remember, is the largest dural sinus. It starts at the foramen cecum in the anterior part of the cranial cavity and then goes along the superior margin of the falx cerebri and then goes back to drain into the confluence of sinus. Then we have the inferior sagittal sinus. The inferior sagittal sinus goes along the inferior edge of the falx cerebri and it receives mainly tributaries from the falx itself, as well as some small veins from the medial surface of the cerebral hemispheres. The straight sinus drains the inferior sagittal sinus into the confluence of sinuses. More anteriorly, we will find the anterior and the posterior intercavernous sinuses, which just connects the right and the left cavernous sinus together. And notice that I've put in brackets variable here, because depending on your source, they can be anterior or posterior or even inferior intercavernous sinuses. But the functions are the same. It just connects the two cavernous sinuses together. Then we have the basilar plexus, which, remember, just connects regional venous structures. Then the transverse sinus drains the confluence of sinuses into the sigmoid sinus. The sigmoid sinus is a continuation of the transverse sinus, and it actually has a pretty cool S-shaped form as it goes towards the jugular bulb of the inferior jugular vein. Then we have the superior and the inferior petrosal sinuses, which drain the cavernous sinus into the sigmoid and the internal jugular vein. Then we have the occipital sinus, and the occipital sinus is the smallest sinus we have, and as you see, it connects with the confluence of sinuses and the sigmoid sinus. Then we have the confluence of sinuses. The confluence of sinuses is not really a structure in itself. Rather, it's just a connecting point of the superior sagittal sinus, the straight sinus, and the occipital sinus. So when these three sinuses meet, they form the confluence of sinuses. Then we have the cavernous sinus. And the cavernous sinus is actually divided by fibrous septae into small caves, and that's where the word cavernous sinus comes from. It comes from the word cave. And if you look at this picture, you will see that there are different structures that passes within the cavernous sinus because the cavernous sinus is divided into these caves. There's this mnemonic for all the structures that go through the cavernous sinus, which is O Tom Cat. So O stands for the oculomotor nerve, which is the third cranial nerve. T for the trochlear, the fourth cranial nerve. Then O and M stands for the ophthalmic and the maxillary branch of the trigeminal nerve. C stands for internal carotid artery. A for the abducens nerve, the sixth cranial nerve. And T is just a filler in order to complete the mnemonic, O Tom Cat. So that was this one. The last one is the sphenoparietal sinuses, which receives tributaries from the adjacent lobes and then drains them into the cavernous sinus to then be drained through the superior and the inferior petrosal sinuses and then into the internal jugular vein. So that was everything I had about the dural venous sinuses. In the next video, we're going to go through the branches of these dural sinuses.